My name is Kevin. I'm so glad to be with you guys today. If there's another video, I'm sorry. Anyway, great to be with you guys today. Welcome to Westside Christian Church. So glad to be with you and worship. And also welcome if you're streaming in or watching this recording. Just want you to know you're all prayed for, and we believe that God wants to speak to all of us and encourage us today. So really excited to be a part of that. I want to invite you to do something that for some people is your least favorite part of church time, especially if you're, you know, extreme introvert. I just want to invite you to stand up and say hi to one person, just one. Look for somebody maybe that you don't know, that you've not met before, but let's say good morning and then I'll bring us back together. Thank you.
Work hard, pray more, dream big. I'm going to tell you what I got to do to make my dreams come true. Work hard, pray more, dream big. Work hard, pray more, dream big. They say reality is often closer than we think, but in reality it's closer than your mind can think. Because you thought it through a thought that you made it up, but your mind was ahead of you. Set a table for two, talking to myself like every day. Put my goals on paper, put it in the microwave. I'm trying to write down the vision and make it plain, hurry up, drive through. Fast lane, gotta do to make my dreams come true. Work hard, pray more, dream big. Work hard, pray more, dream big. I'm gonna tell you what I gotta do to make my dreams come true. Work hard, pray more, dream big. Work hard, pray more, dream big. Yeah. Nobody knows the day, nobody knows the hour. They see overnight success, nobody's holiday and death. A 17-year-old me's dinging for free pizza. 16-year-old me emailing half of Atlanta. Just give me a shot. On your stage, I'll sing, then clean up and put the chairs away. I got a set of values I'm not willing to change. Besides that, early days of hustle, open game, gotta do it to make my dreams come true. Work hard, pay more, dream big. Work hard, pay more, dream big. I'm gonna tell you what I gotta do to make my dreams come true. Work hard, pay more, dream big. Work hard, pay more, dream big. In my mid-20s, felt on top of the world, till I played my new album for a couple labels. I checked my email, kept refreshing, kept scrolling up, until I realized their silence spoke louder than words. But you work hard and you keep on investing in. You pray more, be sure to listen when he's speaking in. You dream big and don't you worry if it's different. Just stay true to yourself and you just keep on doing what you do. To make your dreams come true. Work hard.
All right, I want to invite you guys to stand. We're going to be singing, I know, I just made you sit down, and now stand up again. Just get the blood pumping. We're going to be singing an oldie but a goodie, and just want to invite you to read the words and really think about this, especially because culturally a lot of people know this song, but sometimes we don't internalize it, and I want to invite us to really think about what we're singing and think about these words as we sing them together.
Was mine.
Please pray with me. God, thank you for this day. Thank you that we could come and worship you. Help our ears to be open, our minds to be open, to see you and to hear from you today. Please help us, Lord, every aspect of the service, help us to experience you. It's in your name we pray, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, everyone. Whether you're joining us in person or via live stream, we're so happy that you are worshiping with us today. We have multiple ways that you can get connected, whether it be a small group or volunteering in certain roles. I do need to get a greeter schedule going, so I have some flyers out on our new little Welcome Center area. If you feel like you meet that criteria of what a greeter is, my contact info is on there. If you will just get with me, I'd love to get a schedule going. As soon as possible, that would be great. Pastor Kevin's Accelerate class picks back up this week right after church. Right after we get done singing our last song and praying, if you are here not attending, if we could just kind of make our way out to the welcome area, that way they could go ahead and get started with their class, that would be fantastic. I will remind you again later. And then there will be no women's small group tomorrow night. Due to the eclipse and all of the things, we were rehearsing this morning. It was kind of funny that the sun forbear to shine in the song we just sang, and we did not do the math on that until, so that was funny. So little things in life. If you haven't already, please be sure to download the WSCC and FLC Church Center app. You can scan the QR code. There's a church calendar on there, and you can also give in the app as well. And there's a basket out next to the coffee station that you can drop off your prayer request or a connect card that's in the back of your pews, also at the end. So if you guys would like to drop those off on your way out, we'll be sure to pick those up. And that is all I have, if you'll pray with me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for getting us all here safely and be with those who are watching us via live stream. We're just so thankful that we could all be here and here for the same purpose, Lord, to just praise your name. And just be so thankful that we got to wake up for another day and just bring us back here safely next week or via live stream, whichever way, just keep us all connected, Lord. We just thank you for your love and in your honor and glory forever. In your name we pray, amen. Amen.
The next part of worship, a lot of people think, oh, this is the money part. This is where the church, thinks about paying their bills. And I just want to say that's really not what this is. This is just a part of worship that we unashamedly give people an opportunity to worship God with their time and money. And so I just want to invite you. That amount is between you and God. And if you're visiting today, there's certainly no obligation for you to give. This is really for the church family. To worship God in this way. You can do it, as Sarah said, online. There's also a box in the back if you prefer that. And we're also going to pass around some trays as well, though I don't see them right.
They're right here, right
back. Okay, thank you. So those are some ways you can give, but we're going to sing a song during this time that is really what offering is about, which is giving ourselves away. That's really what God wants, is he desires our hearts and our trust, and he loves to provide for us. That's what offering is about, is trusting him with our resources and trusting that he will provide. He will bless us in order to be a blessing to others. So I'm going to pray for us, and then these guys are going to facilitate that, and we'll sing, and I just invite you to sing with us, or at least listen to these words, I give myself away. So let me pray. God, we do trust you. We give it to you. For those of us who are holding on to things, help us to release and trust you with it, whatever it is. God, some of us, we have private things, and we certainly feel like our money is private, it's ours, but your word is very clear that it's all yours. Help us to let go of control and power. Help us to trust you with our lives and our resources. It's in your name we pray, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
The next song we're going to do is new, and I just want to encourage you to listen. We're going to learn it because we're actually going to all, you can sing if you know it or if you feel comfortable, but we're going to all sing it together at the very end today for sure. So I just invite you to learn and listen to these words. The message today that God put on my heart is all about opposition that all of us face in life. And so this song is about God being our defender. And I just want to invite you to really consider if you've not made God your defender, your protector, your provider, that's what he wants for us. And so that's what this song is about, is him being willing to be our defender, but we have to let him. We have to yield to him, and he will defend and provide for us. So I just invite you to listen, and if you feel comfortable to sing, please do, but just invite you to really do business with God in your heart this morning. Amen. I want to invite the rest of the worship team. Thank you, Danielle. I want to invite the rest of the worship team to come up, and we're going to sing one more song. And I want to invite us to stand together, and we're going to sing this song, Build My Life. And it's really an invitation. If your life is in Jesus, that's awesome, and we can celebrate that. If your life is not yet in Jesus, or if you're on the fence about it, this is really an invitation to think about building your life in Jesus and what that would be, because he offers peace that passes understanding. It's a different kind of peace than what the world offers. But I want to invite everybody to stand, stretch your legs if you're able, and let's sing this prayer to God together.
Oh,
God, please speak to us. Please help us to know you as you really are, not just as we want you to be or as we think you are. Again, we thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord. It's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Awesome. If the communion people want to come forward, that'd be great. Thank you. Well, again, good morning. I want to invite you, if you have a Bible with you, to take your Bible and open to Nehemiah chapter 4. Nehemiah chapter 4, it's on page 424. In my Bible, it's 424. Nehemiah chapter 4. Well, if you were anywhere else but the Evansville area, on Tuesday, there was a storm. There was a storm on Tuesday. And when storms happen, some manly men have an impulse to do things like go and get more chainsaw blades. I'm jealous of that impulse because when a storm happens, my impulse is to start writing down sermon illustrations. I do things like I go to Home Depot and Lowe's so that I can feel more masculine, so I can look like, you know, I've got a project going on. I'm looking for air fresheners and things like that, and light, you know, flashlights and stuff like that. Most pastors that I know are, you know, we're not great at fixing things with our hands, but we like, you know, thinking about systems and people and churches and things like that. But there was a serious storm on Tuesday, and I want to acknowledge that some of you feel like you're in a storm in your life right now. Maybe you feel like you've gotten caught in a storm and you just have to pull over because you're not sure how you're going to get through it. And I want to acknowledge that some of you don't just feel like you've gotten caught in a storm. Maybe you feel like you've gotten caught in a storm in the woods and you're running out of food and water and it's dark. That's a serious situation. Some of you feel like life has just, as one of my friends says, life has just gotten really lifey for you, and you've gotten caught maybe in the thorns, in the stickers. Maybe it's like a storm right now at night, and you're in the woods, and you're lost, and you have a wound, and you're bleeding out. I know some of you, and I know that's where some of us find ourselves, and we're asking questions like, what does God have to say to my situation? You know, maybe it's a financial storm. Maybe it's a relational or family storm. Maybe there's a situation with a child or a parent. Maybe you're in a place in life where really your physical body is breaking down and you're starting to think about, where's God in this? How does the living God apply to my situation? And I just want to encourage you this morning. I believe God wants to speak hope and light to you today. Earlier this year, I started a series called Rebuilding Your Life, and it's very practical for me because the last couple years I have found myself in multiple storms and just asked God, where are you in this? In very practical ways. And so I'm excited to open up Nehemiah because in so many ways, Nehemiah was living a good life. He was the wine taster for the king of Persia. That was his job, and he was living comfortably, and his career was going well. But one of his brothers came to him and said, you know, things back home are not going well, back in Jerusalem. The temple's been rebuilt. You know, this is 5th century BC. The temple's been rebuilt, but there's no wall to protect the community or the temple from other people who would come to wage war against the temple. And so Nehemiah's life really took a surprising turn. He was comfortable. And God said, no, we're going to do something that is uncomfortable. Maybe that's where you find yourself, that you find yourself uncomfortable and you're saying, where's God in this? I thought as a Christian that things are supposed to get easier. And we're going to see at least, you know, in Nehemiah's life that he's following God and things did not get easier. And yet he was right where God wanted him. So we've gone through the first three chapters and we've seen him pray about it. We've seen him weep and wait and seek God's face and say, where are you in this, God? And, you know, God led him to build a team and head back to Jerusalem and begin to assess and start to build. And we saw him actually fundraise and ask the king of Persia to support his mission, which he did. He financially supported all of it. He wrote orders so that no one would attack him, and he took a team back. In Nehemiah chapter 3, we saw at least 43 different groups of people that were involved in rebuilding this wall. I know it's hard for us to understand. I mean, some of us live in gated communities, but this is a kind of a different situation. This is a wall to literally protect them so they can not be killed by other people, other tribes. So they set out to rebuild this wall. And just to give you just some of the facts about this wall, it's about 2.5 miles long, and the wall averages 39 feet tall. It's different heights at different points. And it's about 8 feet thick of stone. Okay, so it's a serious undertaking for this group of people to engage in the building of this wall. And what we're going to see today is that they're not just, you know, building this wall. They're not just at this construction site, you know, by themselves. They're actually being harassed by people, the surrounding leaders that don't want them to complete the work. And we're going to ask a very practical question, you know, why does God allow opposition into our lives? You know, some of us are just, if we're being honest, we're asking a very real question, like, why is life so hard? I was thinking about that on Wednesday and Thursday morning while my power was out. I was thinking, why does my refrigerator stuff have to go bad? You know, like, of all the things, you know, why is it so hard? Why? Well, we're going to take a look today at various forms of opposition and what Nehemiah does in response. And I believe there are some encouraging takeaways for us today. So first and foremost, let's look at the first form of opposition from the governor of Samaria and the governor of the Ammonites, who come and just start mocking and name-calling and ridiculing Nehemiah. So look with me, if you would, chapter 4, starting in verse 1. When Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, "What are those feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from these heaps of rubble, burned as they are?" And the other person, Tobiah, the Ammonite, who was at his side, said, "What are they building? If even a fox climbed up on it, he would break down their wall of stones." I want to pause here for a second. I don't know if this phrase is used anymore with little kids, but it was popular when I was little. Sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Actually, as it turns out, not true. Not true. Words are more damaging than sticks and stones. Words matter. Words matter, and that's why the opposition to the building come and use words. They are mocking Nehemiah and the people of God. They are ultimately mocking God. They are name-calling. They are ridiculing. And I just want to ask, have you ever experienced someone dismissing you, mocking you, making fun of you and something that you wanted to do that was important. I believe it happens all the time, and it's happening here to Nehemiah, and I want to ask, what does Nehemiah do about it, and how does it apply to us? Well, the first thing that Nehemiah does is he prays, and actually I think it's a surprising kind of prayer. It's a prayer for justice. You know, people ask me all the time, Kevin, how can I pray effectively? How can I increase my prayer life? And my encouragement is read the Psalms, read the prayers of David, because they are very honest, authentic prayers. He has a very real relationship with God, a very raw relationship with God. And in fact, King David, in Psalm 3, Psalm 10, Psalm 58, he actually says, God, break their teeth. These people are coming against me. Break their arm, God. And I know, nice religious, nice and neat Christians, oh, we say, oh, that language makes me uncomfortable. That language makes me uncomfortable. It sounds vindictive. But here's the beautiful thing. God can handle it. All God says is, be real with me and don't take out vengeance yourself. God says, come to me. Bring your anger, your fear, your sadness, all of it. Bring it to me. And that's what David does. And after all, what does God say about David? It's a man after my own heart. David was very broken. He made all kinds of mistakes in his life. And yet, God said, David gets it. Most of the Psalms are written by David because his relationship with God is so real and honest. He knows he's messed up. He doesn't see the whole picture, but he comes to God honestly and says, God, help me with these people. I just want to confess to you myself, you know, in 30 years of pastoral ministry and mission work, there have been some hard things in my life that I've experienced. There was a season in which for about 9 months, I could not listen to white preaching. I just want to tell you, I was not interested in listening to white male preachers because I had experienced injustice and hurt and evil and wrong. And I wanted to hear from preachers who had lived it, who had lived injustice and evil, and yet they were following God honestly. They were following God openly. You know, so many people say, what injustice are you talking about? What kind of injustice? And I say, there's all kinds of injustice that's happening in the world. There is all kinds. Anybody who's been poor, I mean really poor, you know the pain of desperation. You know the pain if you've experienced death face-to-face of a loved one. You know the pain of sitting before the living God and saying, but God, how is this possible? God, this hurts. If you've experienced evil in front of you, someone lying, cheating, stealing, and getting away with it, you know David's heart. And you stand before the living God and you say, but God, I am honest and I'm struggling. How is it that the wicked prosper? How is that? That's the prayer of Nehemiah here in the face of this ridicule. In verse 4, Nehemiah says, hear us, O our God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight, for they have thrown insults in the face of the builders. So I want to invite us, in the face of people showing contempt towards you, in the face of haters and name callers, people who do not want you to prosper, pray for them. Seek God's face for them. Because he really hears, he really listens. Nehemiah is honest with God about where he is, and he knows that God can handle whatever broken prayers he prays, that God is big enough. God can handle it. Furthermore, he doesn't just pray. Look at what verse 6 says. So we rebuilt the wall till all of it reached half its height. For the people worked with all their heart. I love this because so many people want to have this conversation about God's sovereignty and human responsibility. You know, predestination versus free will. Can we just trust God and do nothing? No. Nehemiah lives out, trust God and work hard. Trust God and use your common sense. Do not throw common sense out the door. People say to me all the time, why is this so hard? Well, Jesus never promised it would be easy. Jesus says, in this world, you will have trouble. You will. It's not supposed to be easy. Sometimes you have to fight 2 inches at a time. Sometimes it's 5 steps back and 1 step forward. Sometimes it is crawl forward. It is going to be hard. It is pray and seek God's face. But as Nehemiah says, we rebuilt the wall, for the people worked with all their heart. There is going to be opposition. In fact, what I say to us this morning, and I'll come back to this at the very end, some of us have this wrong thinking that if we're doing the right things, we should not face opposition. Oh, I disagree. I believe biblically, and look at the life of Jesus, that if you're doing the right things, you will face opposition. Jesus said himself, I did not come to bring peace the way the world brings peace. I came to bring a sword in relationships. Sometimes pushing the envelope and conflict is necessary. And this last week I had the privilege of going to the movie theaters and watching The Chosen season 4, and the disciples and some others are saying to Jesus, calm this language down. They're going to try to kill you. They're going to kill you. They're going to hurt you. Don't escalate this, Jesus. Don't escalate it. And Jesus says, oh, no, you don't understand why I've come. I've come to push the envelope against evil. I've come to create conflict, good conflict. Jesus has not come to resolve conflict. He's come to advance the kingdom of God against a real enemy that does not want him or you to succeed. So I say, if you're facing the right kind of opposition because you're doing good things, and we live in a world where this world is broken, and according to the New Testament, we have our selfishness or our flesh working against us, and then there is a real enemy, Satan himself, who comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And according to the Bible, 1/3 of all the angels are working with him against you and me. That's real. That's not comic book stuff. That's real. So if you're facing opposition for doing the right thing, stay on track. Keep going. Some of us are not in the fight. Some of us are not in the game. So you're experiencing peace and prosperity. And I'm here to tell you, get in the game. Get in the game until the enemy pushes back. If the enemy is not pushing hard against you, maybe you're not even in the game. This life is not about eating, drinking, and being merry and just sitting and enjoying things. No, this is kingdom warfare. The invitation is to be a part of God's kingdom against the kingdom of darkness that is very real in this world. All right, so the first thing we see here is ridicule and contempt. The second kind of opposition that we see in this chapter is plotting and scheming, and some of us are experiencing that. Look with me at verse 7 and following. But when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the men of Ashdod heard that the repairs to Jerusalem's walls had gone ahead and that the gaps were being closed, they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. Their response, verse 9, but we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. So first and foremost, you know, conspiracy, it's not a new thing. These people are coming together and plotting or scheming against Nehemiah. Have you ever experienced, maybe you need to think back to your grade school years on the playground. Maybe you need to think back to a time when people schemed against you. You knew there were conversations going on about you. That's what's happening here. There are conversations that are happening, and Nehemiah knows these are conversations about me, and these people want to come against me and take me out. So what is it that Nehemiah does? I think it's so beautiful. Again, we see prayer and action. Some of us lean towards action. Some of us lean towards prayer, but it's a both and application here. We see Nehemiah pray and use his common sense. He doesn't just trust that angels are going to protect them. You know, some people in our culture take a stand against things like medicine. And I just want to say that here, according to this passage, it's a both and principle. That Nehemiah is certainly trusting in God by seeking his face and praying, but he's also using common sense and saying, God is going to use our soldiers to protect us. He uses common sense. You know, I love the phrase, don't just stand there, do something. And the doers love it, you know. Don't just stand there, do something, take action. Some of us need to hear today, don't just stand there and pray, do something. Use your common sense. Take action against whatever opposition you're facing. We don't throw out common sense. In fact, we are supposed to be people of the truth, and so we do not have to choose between wisdom and faith. It's both and. We completely trust God, but we use wisdom. We use wisdom. So don't just stand there and pray, do something. But you know, the opposite is also true. Don't just do something, stand there and pray. Some of us are inclined to just start acting, and we take action at a frenetic pace. We just start doing. Maybe some of you, when you get stressed out, you just find yourself, I just gotta do something. Honestly, for me, it's always dishes and laundry. You know, just get going on dishes and laundry. If I don't know where to start, I need to do some dishes and laundry. Just get going. Do something. But it's both and, according to this passage. Nehemiah prays and also they post a guard day and night to meet this threat. All right, so we've seen two kinds of opposition. We're going to enter into Numbers 3 and 4, and I promise we'll deal with it briefly, but I think it's very practical because the opposition escalates. First, it started as words, started as ridicule, being dismissed and disrespected. Some of you are experiencing that in your lives right now. Then the opposition in this passage moves to scheming or plotting, people gossiping and slandering you, talking behind your back about how to deal with you or put you in your place. Nehemiah prays about it and he takes action. He takes action. Well, the next one is discouragement from within. This is now not just the cultural enemies. This is the actual insiders who are helping them with the wall. They're discouraged. It's not going as fast as they want it to. It's harder than they think it should be. Look with me at verse 10. Meanwhile, the people in Judah said, "The strength of the laborers is giving out, and there's so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall." They are discouraged. They're overwhelmed. They're looking at where they want to go versus where they are, and they're saying, "I don't think we're going to get there. I think we're going to run out of resources. I don't think we can do this." That's what they're saying. And these are people who are followers of God. They feel discouraged. I just want to say, discouragement is very real. If you are feeling discouraged today, you're not alone. You're not alone. We are going to ask the question, does this passage say what to do about this? And we're going to see Nehemiah encourage these people very much with the person of God and who he is and the word. Discouragement is so easy in our culture, guys, especially because of social media. You start looking at social media and, you know, you see all this stuff by other people who seem to be doing so well. I mean, that's at least my story. I see my college friends and they look so happy, and I just have to admit to you, I'm like, yeah, number one, I'm jealous, and number two, I don't think it's all true. People want to project that they're doing better than they actually are. And so it's easy to feel discouraged. It's easy to look at our circumstances first and say, you know what? I'm not where I thought I would be. I'm not where I think I should be. I'm not where other people tell me I should be. And so then you start to feel discouraged. And encouragement is like a bucket that leaks. You got to find ways to encourage yourself. You got to find ways to find hope. And I just want to tell you, this book, I encourage you to read God's word. It's not about being religious. It's not about just doing it out of discipline. Guys, I do it because I'm desperate for hope and encouragement. And I encourage you to find a preacher who wants to encourage you, not someone who makes you feel like you got to work harder, just do better, or as my 14-year-old says often, just get on my level. Of course, he's joking when he says that, but sometimes you go to church and you actually feel worse at the end of the service than you came in. Should not be that way. So Nehemiah here faces discouragement from their own people, from his own team. Then, as if, you know, ridicule, scheming, and discouragement is not enough, we're going to see, starting in verse 11, just intimidation and threats of violence that are coming. What to do in the face of that? Verse 11 says, "Also our enemies said, before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them and will kill them and put an end to the work. Then the Jews who lived near, Oh, I lost my place. Verse 12. Then the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times over, wherever you turn, they will attack us. Therefore, I stationed some of the people behind the lowest points of the wall at the exposed places, posting them by families with their swords, spears, and bows. I just want to say, threat of violence is very real. Once people start using words against you, it's only a matter of time before it escalates to violence or attack. Maybe someone is trying to intimidate you right now. What do you do about it? Does the Bible say what to do about it? I want to look at what Nehemiah says here, starting in verse 14. After I looked things over, I stood up and said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your brothers, your sons, and your daughters, your wives, and your homes. I just want to say, leaders should be standing up and reminding people around them, do not be afraid. This is an attack of the enemy. And I just want to speak this over leaders. You know who you are. You know when you're in a room full of people and discouragement or fog comes over and people are starting to doubt the goodness or the power of God. It is on us, leaders, to say, hold on a second. God is on his throne. In the midst of a storm, the electricity may go out. The food in the refrigerator may go bad. You may be lost. You may have stumbled and fallen. But I want to invite you, leaders, to step up like Nehemiah and say, hold on a second. We serve a great and awesome God, and we do not judge his reality based on our circumstances. We are going to trust him and his word and his character, even if our eyes and our body tell us that things are really hard right now. I want to invite you, leaders, to be who you are and to speak against fear and discouragement. To rise up and be the men and women that God has called you to be. Encourage people. People in our world are discouraged, living in darkness, and they're wondering, does the church have any answers? And it is the leaders, if it's in you, if it's burning in your heart like it burned for John Wesley, I want to encourage you to step up and speak life to people in the midst of darkness. We do not shy away from it because this world is a dark place. People are hurting. People are discouraged. That's actually what God majors in. People who are scared and discouraged. But it's going to be hard. Hard work is required. I think it's interesting to see what's written next here. Verse 15, when our enemies heard that we were aware of their plot and that God had frustrated it, we all returned to the wall, each to his own work. From that day on, half of my men did the work while the other half were equipped with spears, shields, bows, and armor. The officers posted themselves behind all the people of Judah who were building the wall. Those who carried materials did their work with one hand and held a weapon in the other. And each of the builders wore his sword at his side as he worked. But the man who sounded the trumpet stayed with me. Then I said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, the work is extensive and spread out. We're widely separated from each other along the wall. Wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there. Our God will fight for us. So we continued the work with half the men holding spears from the first light of dawn till the stars came out. At that time, I also said to the people, have every man and his helper stay inside Jerusalem at night so they can serve us as guards by night and the workmen by day. I love this final statement in verse 23. Neither I nor my brothers nor my men nor the guards with me took off their clothes. Each had his weapon, even when he went for water. There's so many things here that are practical, but I just want to highlight, it's hard work. It is not supposed to be easy. For those of you that are, you're feeling the weight of your job and your calling, it is hard work. It is discouraging. There is opposition. Most of the time, it's going to feel like the wind is against you. And Nehemiah says here, it was such hard work that we did not change our clothes. And they were there for 52 days. They did not change their clothes. They camped out. He took 50% of his resources to guard the people. And then they took turns. They switched. They stayed out all night protecting. So many people think, oh, it should be easy, right? We're advancing the kingdom. No. We live in a world that is fallen and broken. We live in a culture that has taken its stand really against God and the things of God. Everything people do in the name of Jesus is going against the wind. Thank you for your hard work. Thank you for persevering. The storms are going to come. It's going to be heavy work. Raising godly children is so hard. It is so hard. Being married, staying married, you've got two sinners. And every marriage is cross-cultural, by the way. You're learning how to communicate with another human being who's completely different from you, who comes from a different family tree with its own brokenness. It is hard work. But I believe that Jesus is there with us. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are there with us so that we can persevere. And that's what church is supposed to be about. Doing life together. I want to invite you. Rise up. Keep going. One of my good friends in seminary, he said he had made some choices and was just about done. He was going to walk away from ministry. And I just, as soon as he told me that, we just talked about a week ago about it, and I had forgotten that conversation. It's almost like, you know, you have this cross and it just falls to the ground, and you have to decide, am I going to pick it up again and keep walking? And I just want to say to you guys, pick it up and keep going. Pick it up and walk on. Keep going. You got this. Let's do it together. Please pray with me. And worship team, I want to invite you to come up. Sarah and Danielle. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you've not left us alone, but you offer us hope and encouragement. Help us, Lord, to keep going. Help us to persevere, to stay the course. And for those of us who, Lord, you're challenging to get in the game, help us to have the courage to get in the game, even with wounds and scars and fear. Help us, Lord, to trust you. Oh God, that I pray that our faith would overcome our fears. It's in your name we pray, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I want to invite you, just in response to God's word, if you are able to stand, and let's now sing this song, Defender, together, and then we'll close. But I just want to invite us, and if you're in a place to just listen, that's fine. But I do invite us to sing as you feel able. Thank you, Lord, that you are our defender. Help us to seek your face. Thank you for all that you do. It's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Guys, thanks for coming. Thanks for tuning in. Have a great day. Feel free to hang out here for about 5 minutes, and then I would love for us to transition into the lobby area so we can start a class in here. Thank you.